John Clendaniel. I'm from Delaware State University. And our first speaker is Steve Mirsky, which is from USDA. He's at the ARS Beltsville, and he's going to give one more round of talks. We certainly appreciate Stephen putting in the added effort, because not only has he given multiple talks here for us, he has set up quite a bit for the tour. So with that, Stephen.
For those of you who saw my talk yesterday, I was kind of more setting up big picture stuff for Greg and Shored for all of the establishment technology and planting. Now we're going to get into some of the meat and bones of nutrient management with cover crops. So we're going to go through a lot of figures. Some of them are busy. We're going to walk through them together really slowly. And if there's any questions, comments, let's keep this informal. Ask me on the spot. It's a little bit blinding with the light, so raise that hand up high because I can barely see folks back there. But okay, let's get started. We're going to talk about managing cover nitrogen with cover crops. Okay, obviously, the first step in thinking about providing nitrogen to your subsequent cash crop is going to be starting with legumes and what we can do with legumes. They're certainly the source of new nitrogen into the system. Generally, legumes have fairly low CN ratios. Most of the legumes are all below 20, can range between 10 to 18 as far as their carbon to nitrogen ratios. They rapidly mineralize nitrogen and decay. They're not very good at weed suppression, and they can have some concerns with leaching, and we're going to look at that and look at the decomposition of cover crops. But when you compare these to mineral fertilizers, they have a slower release rate. They do have a much lower energy use. So just the energy embodiment to produce mineral fertilizer is quite high. So legumes represent a really big reduction in overall carbon footprint, for example, of your nitrogen source. And they're a renewable resource, clearly. And compared to manure, they don't have that same volatility issues. They don't have the transport issues. And they certainly don't come with all that pee that we have concerns with manure. So there's a lot of advantages, certainly, to legumes. And so here's some of the common ones in our area. As far as winter annual cover crops go, hairy vetch is one of the workhorses. I know there's a lot of concerns. There continues to be concerns with hairy vetch, and very well, you have every right to be concerned with hairy vetch. We are working on the hard seed issue. We have many field crop production systems where it is not an issue at all. So I think there is certainly a history of concerns with vetch, but I also do think that a lot of it is perception-based. We have a lot of functional long-term cropping systems experiments with hairy vetch in them where we don't have any problem of hairy vetch as a weed in winter wheat. So I think that this is something that we need to stop just assuming is our worst-case scenario. But anyway, this is a very productive cover crop, very winter-hardy. Of all of our cover crops, probably one of the more winter-hardy. Rapid growth, good ground cover, provides a little bit more weed suppression as a mulch than some of the other legumes. Crimson clover, another common one, particularly as you get into the southern. For most folks who are in the northeast here, you're not using crimson clover. It's really when you start to get into southern PA and Maryland, crimson clover is very popular. And then Austrian winter pea, a lot of folks are excited about Austrian winter pea because it has the potential to maybe get more winter hardy, particularly with some breeding, and it doesn't have the hard seed concerns that hairy vetch has. So this is one of the reasons why folks are more and more attracted to Austrian winter pea. But by and large, consistently across the board, hairy vetch is the better biomass producer, which means more nitrogen overall. So let's look at this figure that everybody saw the first day of the meeting. So this was some data that Matt shared from a big collaboration across all of these sites that we set up. And let's just ignore the sites. And let's just look at biomass. And whenever I have slides that have kilograms per hectare, I'm sorry, some of my slides got converted, some didn't. Pretty much kilograms per hectare is about the same thing as pounds per acre. So when you see kilograms per hectare, just think pounds per acre. It's about the same thing. It's really close. So anyway, when we're at this lower biomass levels, this is how much plant available nitrogen you can expect. So this is plant available nitrogen. This is not total nitrogen. So plant available is what the crop will see in that growing season. And so with a low biomass levels in the like 1,300 pounds per acre of biomass, that's what you can expect. When you start to get up into the 3,000 to 4,000 range, this is the kind of range of nitrogen you can expect. And it's really not until you get up into these really high biomass, you know, 6,000 pounds per acre of a legume, where you start to get into these nitrogen levels that are almost equivalent to what our end needs are for a cash crop. When we think about cover crops, though, we need to be thinking multifunctional needs, right? Cover crops provide a number of services and benefits. And so when we're developing our cover cropping systems, this is one of the reasons why, you know, mixtures are becoming more and more popular, is because growers are interested in addressing multiple objectives on their farm. And for example, in this case, I'm highlighting herbicide resistance. So whether you're an organic farmer or you're a conventional farmer, weeds are a big issue. It's in our region, herbicide resistance is only going to become more and more of a concern. It's coming our way in a bigger and bigger way. And for organic producers, obviously, weeds are a continuous issue. So when we're thinking about our nutrient management programs and cover crops are part of that, we should also be thinking about the implications for weeds as well as other services. And so this is why we have to really think about grasses and legumes in combination. In fact, I really rarely look at applying a cover crop need and just use a pure legume. There's just too many advantages to adding a grass or other species, and depending on how you add them and the quantity or the seeding rates. But the point is that mixtures really have a lot of advantages. You know, in the case of a grass, you have high weed suppression capability but very low nitrogen. And the legume, you have low weed suppression and a high nitrogen supply. So let me tell you what you're looking at right here. All right, so this is a figure just to exemplify my point, that we created a gradient, and you can see this, 100% rye, 80% rye, 60% rye, 40, 20, 0, and increasing vetch. So on the right is vetch, on the left is rye in this case, okay? And this whole presentation is going to be a lot of this, the ratio of rye and vetch. Let's just ignore rye and vetch particularly as a species. A lot of what I want to talk about today is just the principles of managing grass and legumes. Whether it was rye or triticale or barley is not as important. Certainly there's some nuance and implications for species at your given farm or who you're working with. But let's just think more broadly and just think in terms of grasses and legumes. But my whole example is going to play out in this case study we did with rye and hairy vetch. And so what you're not seeing here is that we had 5 growth stages of corn that we were presenting and all of the weed biomass at these different mixture ratios. And essentially, we had almost no weed biomass as soon as we added a little bit of rye. So the pure vetch had weedy issues all throughout the growing season, from early on till late, and it kept getting worse and worse and worse. But as long as you had even as low as 20% rye in that mixture, you had huge implications for managing weeds. And so again, targeting this multifunctionality I'm trying to highlight. So grasses, this is the other part of that equation. So I've been highlighting the need to integrate them, and clearly we know a lot about cereals. This is the dominant cover crop of choice for most producers. Tremendous end scavenging capabilities, very winter hardy, lots of flexibility with establishment, has high carbon to nitrogen ratios, except when it's small. So, you know, these small cover crops like this can be in the 25 to 35 range, but then as soon as they start to mature, that CN ratio goes way up. And let's look at that, actually. So this is a nice figure. I'm glad the figure actually showed up. So this is some data that we did. So we've been doing a lot of these multi-site studies. So where we're asking these questions all up and down this East Coast corridor, working with, you know, Cornell, Penn State, BARC, where I'm at, North Carolina State University. You've seen some of the major players. Bill Curran has been mentioned a number of times, Matt Ryan, Masood up in Massachusetts. So this is an experiment where we were looking at rye's responsiveness to nitrogen. So we created this continuum of N availability in the fall, and so how rye responded to that. And I don't really want to highlight all of this these dynamics here, but the things I want you to cue into is this. So it's supposed to say tillering and anthesis, or flowering. So this is at the tillering phase when rye is small, and this is when it's at the flowering stage. And this is just fall applied nitrogen, and this is how much nitrogen was taken up by that that cover crop. And so when you compare the no fertilizer application, whatever your base fertility was in the field, and this was a field that we went into that was fairly low, it was a sandy site, we have about 30 pounds of N taken up versus the 60 pounds over here. So you can see the difference between an early kill versus a late kill is about 30 pounds of nitrogen. But what I also thought was really interesting is that look at how little N it took up as it grew. So this is the nitrogen response in rye at tillering. This is how much N it took up while it was young. But essentially, as that plant grew, when you get past that tillering phase, very little nitrogen is being taken up. It's mostly just being translocated throughout the plant while it's assimilating more carbon. So you have more carbon in this system, but not much more nitrogen. You can see these are not very different. So now let's put this together. We've looked at two individual species. We've talked a little bit about their N content and how much N they can provide. So now let's think in terms of mixtures. So I'm going to show a lot of figures like that look like this. So in the bottom now, and I'm sorry for the previous slide, but for the remainder of this talk, hairy vetch will be on this side and rye. But what that means is when there's a zero, that means there's zero hairy vetch. And when there's a one, that means it's 100% rye. So rye is increasing in biomass as the seeding rate of rye. I mean, vetch is increasing in biomass as the seeding rate increases. Rye is increasing in biomass as its seeding rate increases. These are not raw data. These are means from each site. So we have about 8 or 10 site years of data that's in each one of these figures. So, you know, 3 years of data at Pennsylvania, 2 years of data at Beltsville, 2 years at Pennsylvania, 4 years at North Carolina. So there's a lot of sites mixed in here with these values, and these are plotting those means. So I don't actually remember per se what exactly is going on here. This is kind of the theme of how I'm going to present. So again, this is the hairy vetch monoculture. This is the cereal rye monoculture. And then this solid line across the top just represents total biomass. So that's when you add this line to this line, that's how much biomass you get across the mixtures. And I should cue you into this point again, megagrams per hectare. So this 10, that really means 10,000 kilograms per hectare of biomass or 10,000 pounds per acre of biomass. So these are big cover crops. These are not small cover crops, but a lot of the concepts will apply as you decrease in biomass, but still look at these different ratios. So now let's just look at this on a bunch of more site years. Now we have 4 site years that we did this on. And all I want you to cue into, I don't want you to get into all the specifics of the different figures, but look at just the same seeding rates, the same seed lots planted at somewhat similar times, but some different site conditions, different soil fertility conditions, maybe slight differences in planting date and moisture. You can see when you put out everything the same, how different mixtures behave. Mixtures do not behave very well. If you have a high nitrogen environment, you're going to select for a grass. A low nitrogen environment, you're going to select for a legume. And so this kind of science, we need to continue to develop this science. We need lots and lots of evaluations of this kind of performance so that we can start providing more precision in our recommendations to growers. It's never going to be like a herbicide application. It's never going to be like applying mineral fertilizer. But we need to get to the point where we can give more conclusive information to growers about how this is going to behave so that they can estimate or at least predict better what the composition of these mixtures are going to be. And I wanted to just highlight this point from our work, what we found. Generally, in mixtures, you can get a little bit more biomass, but even when you don't get more biomass, the quality increases. And here, when you reach 50% of the biomass is a legume, you reach the same total N content as a monoculture. So when 50% of the total biomass of a rye vetch mixture is hairy vetch, it has the same total nitrogen as a pure monoculture of hairy vetch. And let's look at that more closely. So we're going to break down CN ratios here. So as you recall from the earlier slides, hairy vetch is about 16:1. So that's around over here. Cereal rye, 83:1. That's over here. And this is that continuum. So that's how that CN ratio changes as a function of the proportions. And here, just to highlight that when you're at that 50-50, you're getting really close to that threshold of N immobilization, mineralization, where you start to get the release of that nitrogen. And this is just more site years of the same to give you a sense of how it's behaving. Some years we didn't always get the 80-20, right? Even though we sowed at 80-20, that didn't mean we got 80-20. This is real biomass. This is not what we seeded. So what we got, sometimes when you put out 80-20, you still get 60-40 when it comes to the biomass, and that has a a lot to do with the site conditions. So now let's look at the N content. Let's walk through this really slowly. So this is cereal rye. This black line right here is cereal rye. Okay, we're looking at shoot nitrogen content, so total N content in the shoot. This is cereal rye. As a function of going from pure cereal rye all the way to very low levels of cereal rye, its shoot nitrogen content didn't change much. And then obviously total N content from the hairy vetch, which is the blue, increased considerably. So this is the blue. I'm not going to go into this dashed line. That's how much percentage is biological and fixation. But so just focus on the red, which is total shoot content. So this is total nitrogen you got. And look at this. This right over here, these points represent the monoculture of hairy vetch. And when you look at all of these, generally, the monoculture of hairy vetch seems to correspond well to that 50% numbers I was talking about. When you get about to the 50-50 and you come up, that's when you achieve about the same N content as the pure vetch. So that's the kind of the major take-home point here, is that you can get the same amount of nitrogen in a mixture as you can in a pure monoculture hairy vetch, but how it behaves is quite different. So we know that the four R's are part of the essential approach to managing nutrients, the right rate, source, time, and placement. This is becoming mainstream for all folks as far as nutrient management, and obviously trying to focus on reducing leaching, erosion, and volatility, and most importantly, increasing use efficiency as well. So let's see how we might be able to tackle that with cover crops. Well, when we think about corn, we know that corn starts to, this is corn N uptake. So this is corn taking up nitrogen over time. And this is when it hits that point right over here, right, where it starts taking it up rapidly. That coincides with when we do our side dressing. So part of our precision nutrient management is to side dress when corn is most rapidly taking up nitrogen. So we wanted to look at how cover crops behave and correspond to that and how much synchrony we get with the N available coming from the cover crop with how much the corn needs and when the corn needs it. So these are litter bag studies where we look at the decomposition kinetics of the cover crops. And so this is just a simplified version of our data. We have many, many, many ratios that we looked at. We didn't just look at the 50-50 and the pure vetch and the pure rye. We did this in a till and a no-till application. We actually looked at this with broadcasted poultry litter, all these different scenarios. I just kind of simplify this down to three scenarios here. Pure rye, rye vetch mixture, and pure hairy vetch. And this is where these growth rates that these growth stages I'm talking about that we're trying to target. Here's V7, so side dress period, and here's physiological maturity. And so look at this. In the case of pure hairy vetch, when you incorporate that residue, I drew the line over here, but even look over here, right? This is like almost 15 days after the cover crop's been in the ground. Pretty much most of the nitrogen in that cover crop is soluble at that point. So these cover crops are highly soluble. They're exploding into the soil as soon as they get in there, and they're releasing that nitrogen rapidly. So you need to consider cover crops just as much as a potential concern for nitrogen leaching as our mineral fertilizers. Certainly mineral fertilizers have much higher potential for solubility early on, but these legume cover crops are exploding and releasing a ton of nitrogen, often well before we're even at that side dress point. Now when we look at a no-till application, things slow down. So the rate of N release from the pure hairy vetch on the surface decreases. You still get about the same amount of total N, but it just slows and has better synchrony with that side dress period. And then when we have mixtures, you can see you get the continued better, slower release of that nitrogen. You get less nitrogen, so that means it's tied up in that higher carbon to nitrogen ratio cover crop for longer, and you're not getting it all in that cash crop, but this is a slower release and you're getting better synchrony. So the question is, how are we measuring the amount of N released? And we're basically coming in over time and measuring the N content of these litter bags. So we're studying how much biomass is in there and what the N content of the plant material is. So we're studying how N is being released from these litter bags. And we're doing that in both a till and a no-till application. So in the till, we bury the bags. We're doing everything, but I'm only presenting slices of it. So we track how much is being released from the cover crop and the rate that it's released from the cover crop. We track how much is available in the soil and the changes of inorganic nitrogen in the soil. And we track how much N is in the corn plant, and we track how much N is being taken up in the corn plant over time. So we have pretty much, we don't have a true budget because we're not measuring leaching. And in this same study, actually, we did measure greenhouse gases, so we're getting some sense of denitrification, but it's not a closed nitrogen budget by any means, but we have at least a pretty good handle on many of the fates. But I'm not covering a lot of the end uptake stuff today. And what I want to put a plug in is this is kind of where we're going with this. So we've done a ton of this decomposition work for a bunch of cover crops, but we want to move beyond carbon to nitrogen ratios. Carbon to nitrogen ratios is just a small glimpse of what's really going on out there. The quality of that residue is really what drives its decomposition kinetics, the cellulose, the hemicellulose, the lignin content. And so we have a project that where we're going to be collecting, hopefully, anywhere upwards from like 40 to 50 site years of data per year all across Georgia, North Carolina, Maryland, parts of Pennsylvania, and Virginia, where we'll be tracking the effects of cover crops on farms where we have strips of no cover crop and cover crop. And we'll be monitoring decomposition kinetics throughout the deep profile, water and nitrogen availability. And the goal here is to basically take existing NRCS models and say, are they adequately estimating how cover crops are modifying the water and nitrogen dynamics? And if and to what extent that model doesn't work, we're going to be working on improving those models. But more importantly, we're going to be able to now not have to just think about cover crops as a species or as a carbon to nitrogen ratio, but we can just focus on quality and quantity. So what is the quality of that cover crop? You can have five different species. They all have a quality signature, and there's going to be a certain quantity of it out there. And if we can build models that do that, these could be web-based decision support tools for farmers. They can send off a sample of their cover crops to a lab, get a quick assay reading of what the quality is, and use that to estimate how much N they're going to have across the growing season. Now, in the case of legume cover crops, we can reach maximum yield potential. So here's an example of a study where we created a continuum of fertilizer application rates in corn. So this is just, you know, mineral fertilizer. And then we have a no hairy vetch and hairy vetch, so with and without. And you can see the difference is a great yield. This is about 200 bushels per acre of corn. So you can see in a higher fertility site, when you have a really good hairy vetch biomass, you can reach maximum yields, certainly. A lot of that nitrogen is not just coming from the hairy vetch, it's coming from your base soil nitrogen mineralization potential. And if you've got a highly fertile site, the long history of cover cropping and manure, you're going to easily be able to apply 100 to 120 pounds of nitrogen just coming from that soil alone. So this is something that can be deceiving, and because you're thinking that cover crop is meeting your needs every year, but we know cover crops are variable, and so we know that they don't consistently always reach the kinds of maximum yields we need, so we also have to look at them in integration with other products. And before I go into some of these other products, I want to also mention, now let's just step away from just legumes. A lot of folks are just working with, you know, small rye or rye of different magnitude here of biomass and killing that and planting corn into that. And in these situations, you can potentially get into a low nitrogen environment early on. And we are seeing in some applications, and I'll show some data on that, where there is a yield lag. So early on, and if you're in a pure cereal rye and you plant corn into that pure cereal rye, depending on your fertility program, you could get a yield reduction. And so we haven't done this work. I'm certainly making some suggestions to farmers that they do need to adjust their split application rates, but this work needs to be done. We need to be studying the continuum of split application rates going into cereal rye, because, for example, if you're targeting 150 bushel and you've got a 30, 120 pound split, that 30 pounds might not be enough, and you might need to be raising the starter application rates to offset that yield drag. This is a little bit about nutrient management in our region. I'm not going to go into this in great length, but basically, obviously, when we're adding manure into the system, we've got phosphorus management issues as well, and so balancing the legumes with other manure sources of fertility, we have to always consider that phosphorus, especially in this watershed, and so it's kind of a balance of how much applied amendments and trying to work at these P removal rates rather than at nitrogen needs. So, you know, when you look at poultry litter, right, and this is the breakdown of poultry litter, but the main point I want you to see here is when you apply poultry litter at the N-base needs of the crop, you're way over applying your phosphorus, whereas if you apply it at the P-base rates there, then you're not applying at the N-base rates, so you're not providing all the nitrogen you need, but you're supplementing that legume and ideally not overloading your phosphorus levels. And so how do these products behave? So this is just an example of a few. So this is poultry litter, bulk litter, pelletized poultry litter. These are these poultry litter, feather meal blends, and pure feather meal. And you can see here that basically bulk litter and pellets behave exactly the same. There's not really any difference in the end release and their decomposition. This was not statistically different. But you certainly get a lot more N from your feather meals. And you can see that these products are releasing quite a bit of it fairly rapidly. And this is from an incubation studies that we did indoors in growth chambers. All right, well, in the case of applying manure, there's certainly lots of concerns associated with applying manure. In Maryland, for example, we now have a 48-hour rule where we can't put it on the surface unless we're incorporating it within 48 hours. So there's a lot of issues with manure management, and particularly when you're at a cover crop and soil health workshop, a lot of folks are thinking about cover crops in no-till applications, right? We know a lot of the advantages of no-till. We know a lot of the advantages of cover crops. Most folks who are doing no-till are starting to integrate that or thinking about integrating that. So it does present us some challenges when we have all this excess waste and what do we do with it and how do we get it in there because we can't incorporate and till it in. So we developed a prototype to test some of these questions. This is by no means production ready. Maybe for some vegetable producers it might work. But for us, this is I'm not an ag engineer, I'm a biologist. So I'm going to test the biology. And I know that there's ag engineers out there who are creating the infrastructure to do this. And so you'll see this piece of equipment at my field site today. And this is us subsurface banding poultry litter. So I'm just working with pellets, because I didn't really want to have to modify this equipment to have to grind the bulk litter and then enforce that into these slits. Pellets flow really well. You have a uniform rate. So from a researcher standpoint, it allows me to just cleanly test the application rate and the behavior of these pellets in the soil. And so you can see here this coulter that's cutting that trench, and we're depositing that poultry litter in that trench, and these closing wheels that also basically pinch that soil back together. And so look at that. I mean, it's incredible. 4 inches deep, you've got this perfect plug of poultry litter below the soil surface. And we can do this at a side dress application. So that was part of what we were testing. We know that that's not something that is going to be readily adopted right away. We are looking at planting versus side dress applications with poultry litter. But for this study that I'm going to show you, we're looking at side dress. And I mainly want to just cue you into some of the behavior of the manure with these cover crops. So now we're looking at soil inorganic nitrogen in a grass legume cover crops over time. So this whole column is cereal rye. This whole column is a 50-50 mixture. And this whole column is hairy vetch. And this is the soil nitrogen dynamics at emergence at the fifth leaf stage, silking, milking, and maturity. So these are different species, and these are different growth stages. And what you're looking at here, why I put that picture, is this is where the corn plant is. So imagine this is between the two corn rows. This is 15 inches to here, and 15 inches to here is our corn plant. So the corn plant is essentially right here. And so what you're looking at here, you don't need to take in all the numbers. Just look at the colors. Look at the color changes. The brighter the color and the deeper the green means more concentration of nitrogen. And so what you're seeing here is before we side dress, so this is our side dress banding of poultry litter, you're looking at the behavior of the cover crops. And a pure cereal rye, you have a very low levels of nitrogen in the profile. This is, by the way, 30 centimeters deep. So it's not super deep, but it's about a foot deep. And so this is very little nitrogen profile. The mixtures, you start to see an increase in the amount of available N in the profile across these different cover crops at planting. And then as you go down, you can see those changes. But here's where we banded that poultry litter, and you can see all that hot spot. But look at silking. By the time of silking, all of the nitrogen in that profile that may have been there from the cover crop has been scrubbed. The corn's taking it up rapidly. And what I thought was so interesting about these results is we don't see any color down here. Very little color. It's all red, right? You would think if there's leaching coming from that band, you have this high concentration of nitrogen, that you would have a lot more nitrogen mobility and translocating down the profile and leaching. And so what's happening is that the corn roots are proliferating right in that band. When you go and take these soil samples, it's just like a dense packed, you know, mat of corn roots, taking nitrogen up from these bands as they release. So it is really, really working well for us. There's a lot going on in here as well. So these are these mixture ratios again, hairy vetch. So this is pure cereal rye over here, and this is pure hairy vetch. And so the same. And this is an organic site and a conventional site. And so both have pretty much the same management. We did this for 6 years, or I mean 4 years, at an organic and a conventional site. And there's a bunch of different things to look at. And one treatment here, the red line, this is where we broadcast it. So we come in at planting. Oh, I should back up one more second. All of these are poultry litter application rates at the same rate. It's the P-based rate. So a phosphorus-based rate of poultry litter application. And one, we broadcasted it over the surface of those cover crops and just left it there. We know that that's not allowed in Maryland, but that's what a lot of producers do outside of Maryland for sure. Incorporated means we broadcasted it on the surface and incorporated it. And in the case of organic, then we have to manage it like an organic farmer would. So lots of cultivation and time weeding and all the things that go into organic weed management. And the conventional, that was just basically like a chisel till treatment. And then the subsurface banding was applying that poultry litter at side dress, where we banded it at side dress. And so that, what do I want to cue you into? Let's look at the organic first. Clearly, you're generally increasing in yields regardless of this fertility rate with added hairy vetch, right? From going from left to right, there's more hairy vetch. So we didn't really reach our yield goals with just the poultry litter alone. You can see the yields were a little bit depressed. There's a number of reasons for this. The organic site is not as high quality of a site compared to this conventional site. But generally, you can see that there's this increase in yields, and that as you get above to this around the 60-40 level here, or 50-50 of the hairy vetch rye mixtures, you max out on your yield potential. And this reduction that you're seeing here, that corresponds to the slide that you couldn't see earlier. The slide you couldn't see earlier was showing this increasing weed biomass and pure hairy vetch. So this is weed competition. So more weeds over here, and that's what's going on. And in the conventional systems, these are basically weed-free. And so what you're looking at here is that we did get a yield bump in the subsurface banding compared to the broadcast and the incorporated. Clearly, we are getting a yield lag in the pure cereal rye. So either we don't have enough nitrogen or we have too much immobilized that's preventing that corn from reaching its maximum potential. But this is pretty consistent as you go across. And we know that when we're around here, we've got way more nitrogen than we need to grow corn. I mean, we've got, you know, a soil that's probably producing 60 to 90 pounds. We've got a cover crop that's producing probably over 100 pounds. And we've got poultry litter out there producing 90 pounds. So we've got plenty of N. And so I think that some of this yield draw here is really a lot to do with that immobilization. And then here's looking at surface UAN compared to subsurface banded poultry litter. So now we just applied UAN as a starter and as a side dress application rate, and it was 150 pounds, and this is the nitrogen rate. So now this is subsurface banded poultry litter at the N rate and mineral fertilizer at the N rate. And you can see not very big differences in their yields, and clearly a bump as you go to more vetch. And I think this, again, corresponds to that yield penalty that you can sometimes get from N being immobilized from rye, right? This is a high rye environment, a lot of carbon, and it can be potentially causing that yield bump. And so this is why I think we really need to be thinking more about our starter split application rates.
Did you try the chemical fertilizer, what the maximum yield potential could be from the chemical fertilizer?
Yes. So I didn't present that here. I was trying to simplify the story some, but we also have this exact set of results for bare plots where we had no cover crop, and we had mineral fertilizer treatments across all that. So we had kind of standard nitrogen management programs in bare plots as well as with these cover crops. And then in some cases, we also had excess poultry litter rates. And so you are looking pretty much at it is kind of maxing out right here. This is really kind of where that yield potential is. I don't have that figure in front of me, but the bare plots, if you looked at it, they kind of line up like right here, which just corresponds with that. So that is pretty much our yield max.
So the maximum yield was somewhere around close to 200 bushels, right?
Correct, sir.
I'm going to tell you our story of cover cropping, and I think that's what's best suited here. From my perspective anyway, as an extension specialist that's mostly extension and part researcher, this is our story of trying to integrate cover crops into dairy systems in what I would call the far north region of the Northeast. When I left Montreal this morning, it was very cold. So I am much further north than most people here, except for Andrew Plant, who sits back there from Maine. Oh, and we have one other person. So maybe you'll relate to this a little bit, because this is our experience working with primarily dairy farmers in the far north region to adopt cover cropping. And just so you know, the cows in the far northern region don't talk, just in case you thought. You didn't think they did. Okay, never mind. Let's move on. All righty. In dairy systems, as most people know, most dairy systems are based on perennial forage production. And really, I consider this sort of the ultimate cover crop, where there's no tillage, there's generally diversity of perennial forages being grown, legumes and grasses and sometimes forbs that aren't planted but are still there, like dandelions and chicory and so on. And we generally consider these perennial-based forage systems, you know, high in organic matter with good soil structure and fertility and biology, all the things that we're trying to sort of create by adding cover crops into our annual crop systems. So what I always tell the dairy farmers that I work with on nutrient management planning is really they've got it good. They have the opportunity to really maximize the health of their soils because they have the ability to actually grow a perennial crop and utilize it and make money, rotate with annual crops and cover crops, and then they also have manure in their system. And if they managed all those things together properly, they could really have extremely high-quality soils and probably some of the best quality soils around. But we struggle with putting all those pieces together often. Okay, so most of the dairy farms have perennial forage that's then complemented with annual forages. And most of the annual forages that are grown on the majority of the dairy farms where I am is corn silage. That's the primary annual crop. And it's grown for, you know, good reason. It provides substantial quantity of feed and also a different quality of feed than what they get from their perennial forages. So it complements that system really well. But one of the issues we have in sort of our corn silage rotations is that in most cases, that ground is left bare through the entire, you know, period from harvest until they plant again the next spring. And then it is a row crop grown on 30-inch rows, so then there's still a lot of bare soil between those rows. So we have soils that are very prone to degradation, a lot of slope in Vermont. And really, this is kind of our best opportunity, really, within dairy systems to integrate cover crops. Okay. To be able to do that successfully in the far northern regions brings a lot of challenges. In our dairy systems, hairy vetch is not a conversation we generally have with farmers, because by the time we're usually planting cover crops, you know, it's September, October, and we're waiting for the first snowfall just a few weeks after that. So implementing cover crops in different parts of our region has very different challenges depending on where you are, as you probably know. Where we also see cover crops sort of gaining a lot of popularity is their use as actual forage, other forage crops on dairy farms. And I've seen an increase in farmers planting cover crop species for forages over the last 5 years. And the increase has been quite substantial, especially on many of our organic dairies that are looking to sort of improve their perennial pastures or their perennial hay fields. And they're essentially using these annual forage crops to get those fields kind of refurbished. Okay, so I'll talk about that a little bit. And then, of course, we have all of this combined with a lot of on-farm organic matter. We don't spread manure in the wintertime in Vermont. It's actually against the law. So, I mean, I don't know if anybody's actually been lost in a pile like that, but we do have to store the manure over the winter months in Vermont. Okay, so let's talk a little bit about what we've done in terms of trying to get cover crops integrated into corn silage systems in the far north. And we have kind of two goals here. First, we want farmers to improve their rotations. We do have fields in Vermont that have been in corn silage for at least 30 years. if not longer sometimes. And rotations aren't always great in Vermont, even though they have the opportunity to seed down with a perennial forage and utilize that. I'm from a place that has lots of rocks. Anybody else from a place with a lot of stones? There's major opposition to plowing those fields. So the cornfields stay the cornfields for different reasons. And sometimes, you know, there's only so much ground that's flat enough to grow corn. So it is a reality for many people that their cornfield is actually their cornfield forever. Okay, so what we're trying to do with a lot of these fields is, well, try to figure out how to improve rotations if we can with perennial forages. And then also if we can't, and even if we can, trying to integrate cover crops into these systems. And you can see, you know, what we see in Vermont, and I'm sure you see this other places too. So one of the, I just stopped talking about cover crops as cover crops. They're not that, right? Are they? If you call them a crop, doesn't that mean something different to you if you're a farmer sitting out there? You know, I remember the old definition of cover crops, I think even said like there was no economic value to it. You know, certainly that's changed over the last few years. But when you're working with farmers and you're trying to sell something that has no economic value, it's a hard sell, right? So trying to change our perception and how we talk about these crops is critical to getting them implemented on farms, at least where I'm from. And so they're not cover crops. They're a part of the cropping system, right? A very different way to look at things. That's step one. And we also all know that annual tillage in a monoculture crop just leads to overall poor health. And this is what also has helped me in my area increase cover cropping. Okay? I don't know if I need to show you this. You probably know this. You've probably felt this, that we have more rainfall, we have more severe rainfall, and it's made it difficult for many of our farmers to continue doing what they've been doing. So what happens when what once worked doesn't work anymore? When replanting becomes a part of your cropping schedule, that's no fun. And the last I checked, that cost you money. It didn't make you money, okay? So the weather has helped us integrate cover crops into these systems. The need for forage, additional forage, because of the weather, okay? We've gone through very dry periods in the summer in the Northeast where pasture, cool season pasture, doesn't produce enough. Things have changed, and farmers feel that. And if you're a farmer here, don't be shaking your head. I know what I'm saying is true, okay? Because I'm a farmer too, and I graze cattle, and there were a couple years in a row where we ran out of grass. That's never happened, and not that I've been around that long, but my family's been on that farm for many generations, and things have changed, okay? So all of these things, whether they're good, bad, or indifferent, I guess, are helping us integrate cover crops onto these farms. It's a scary time for a lot of people, but it's also a really exciting time for people like me. The other thing we have going on in Vermont now is that new state regulations basically say that all farmers have to farm to tea. And that's going to change the ability for farmers to grow continuous corn on these fields. So it gives us another avenue to get corn cover crops integrated on the farm. Okay, so what do? I don't go out and tell this story. I don't need to tell them this story. This is what they're living. But my job is to figure out how to get people to look at cover crops and rotations in a way they haven't looked at them before. To help people adopt them, to believe in them, to see the economic value and the environmental value. And when you can do those things, adoption becomes faster and a little bit easier. We've collected data. These are they say cropping system. So CC is continuous corn silage. NC is new corn. So this is corn rotated, corn silage in a rotation with perennial forage. No-till continuous corn silage, and then continuous corn silage with a winter cover crop. And this data was just from 2014 across several locations, some of them on-farm locations, and I think you can see immediately the financial benefit to rotating your crops or planting a winter cover crop. That's money in the bank. That's a lot of yield difference. Now, I know this is research, this is on farms, but I've read about this in books before. I've read about this in Steve's research papers that this happens, okay? But seeing is believing. When a farmer's chopping 22, 23-ton corn, that's what makes a change versus chopping 16, 17-ton corn. And if they can just start implementing a winter cover crop, this is just winter rye. It's not really anything fancy. They're still seeing that significant yield boost. Does that blow your mind? That totally blew my mind. 3 tons? Just from implementing a winter cover crop. I put together our data because we've been actually doing this trial for almost 10 years in different spots. And on average, over those years, we see an on average 2-ton yield increase from just adding a winter cover crop planted by the beginning of October and terminated as soon as humanly possible, because that's how people grow cover crops where I live. You don't have time to let it grow because you've got about 2 weeks to plant before the season's over. Now, seriously, right? Well, in this case, it was tilled under, but we have also looked at just sprayed. Our farmers are seeing this on their own farms. A yield increase from growing corn silage, that helps, or for growing winter cover crops, that helps increase adoption. The other thing we've been trying to better understand is how much nitrogen credit they get from plowing down rotational crops. Our farmers really, they plow down sods all the time. I have alfalfa here. We don't grow alfalfa in Vermont. We have heavy clay soils and cold, cold winters. It doesn't really survive. But helping farmers understand what kind of credits they get and fertilizer savings from plowing down sods, from plowing down cover crops, all the great work Steve is doing, all helps them better understand how growing cover crops and better rotations can make them money. So we see increased yields from rotation and from cover crops. We assume some of that is because of more fertility, right? From the nitrogen from plowing down the sod. The sod we plowed down was tall fescue with a little bit of alfalfa in it, okay? And so we assume that there's more fertility there, but I think there's other things going on as well, and I think you all know that too. So this is some information that we collected over a bunch of years as well, trying to show this to farmers. Essentially, you know, what we've seen over about 5 years is that the cover crops we're plowing under release about 30 to 45 pounds of actual N to the corn crop by the time of top dress, which is kind of what Steve was showing in his data that's much prettier than mine, but and much more scientific. But essentially, we've seen the same thing for years, okay? This is winter rye data, or winter rye, that's planted again by the 1st of October, and it's plowed down into the ground, usually by the third week of May. So the amount of growth that's there is about 6 to 8 inches, a very green, leafy material. And that's because we've got to get the corn in the ground, or else we don't have a long enough season to grow the corn. Okay, so people are literally, you know, getting it established, letting it grow a little bit, and plowing it under. And so on average from that, and these all have manure in the systems, we're getting about 30 to 45 pounds on average. And in some years, we don't quite get that, especially if it's dry. in the spring. It doesn't break down fast enough. And we do have a lot of people that are starting to integrate no-till into their systems. And so this question comes up of, well, do we get that same amount of nitrogen if we're just spraying it out? And the answer really is no. But that's still a question I think that needs to be answered is, well, can you take any credit or not? And I don't know, Steve, if you've kind of figured that out. But you can also see we have tried roller crimping. This is just rye. We don't have enough time to grow vetch in the fall where I'm from. So just using rye obviously does not work because of the nitrogen immobilization that Steve talked about. And the reason this no cover crop one is higher is because we use commercial fertilizer there. Well, no, because this is actually sprayed out at the time, right after planting. So it's about the same size as the incorporated one, which would be 6 to 8 inches. So it's a different material. Yep. And then this is left go, of course. We finally, when I started my job like 14 years ago, I guess, there were 50 acres of cover crop planted on dairy farms in the state of Vermont. I can tell you where they are. I can bring you to that farm. I talked to the guy at length. Why are you doing this? So on and so forth. Last year, we had 30,000 acres. Give it up for Vermont, right? We only have 90,000 acres of corn, period. So, I mean, I'm not saying I had everything to do with that, but adoption is happening very quickly. We went from 14,000 to 30,000 acres in about a year. So people are really catching on to this, and they're seeing the benefit. They're seeing the yield increases, so on and so forth. So now what are the farmers pushing us to do? Well, because all of you guys are publishing all this fancy stuff in different magazines that say, you need tillage radishes, and you need this, and you need legumes, and you need to have this mixture. Now our farmers in the far north, they want to do that too. So now I've got to try to figure out, how can we actually grow mixtures in Vermont? And we're working on it, and we're working with Greg's interseeder, and we've got a high boy, and you know we're trying to do all kinds of things to get these alternative cover crops and mixtures into the corn silage, but it's going to be difficult for us to achieve. But what we have found when we have been successful with the interseeder is that we know that these annual cover crops take nitrogen, quite a bit of nitrogen out of the soil too. And so this is nitrates actually in the soil, and obviously it makes sense if there's a cover crop growing, there's less free nitrate in the soil in the fall. What we have not figured out yet, and I'm not sure, maybe there were already talks on this today, is how much of this is actually left for the crop next year. And that's what the farmers want to know. Is there any, I mean, there's benefit to growing mixtures and annual mixtures, but these things die in Vermont. You know, they don't live. What kind of nitrogen are they going to get from that the next year? What's the benefit of trying to make this work for us? One of the things that I've been excited about, too, is that we know that these cover crops are taking up other nutrients, obviously. We talk a lot about nitrogen because farmers are most interested in that, and legumes and so on and so forth. But we have a lot of leaky soils in Vermont, too, that are they're lacking in potassium especially, which is hard to believe with the amount of cow manure we put on. But, you know, how do we retain some of that potassium? We have people putting on, you know, or needing at least a couple hundred pounds of potassium every year to grow corn on these river bottom soils. Are cover crops an avenue to actually take up some of that potassium and hold it on those leaky soils? And again, this is actual potassium in the soil, so it's lower in the soils, right, where there's cover crops being grown. But again, somebody here needs to answer this question, not me. What happens to it after those cover crops die? Okay? And in our system, I don't know. You know, is it available for the corn or not? So there's a lot of work to do there. So we have been able to establish clover in the corn, but for us, you know, most of these systems are conventional and thinking about herbicide management. I don't know if anybody's talked about that here, but this is a big deal for us. If you're trying to seed broadleaf crops into corn fields at V4 and V6, how do you manage the herbicides so these things don't die? And our farmers really want to know the answer to that. So I'm just telling you everything we need that hopefully you guys can produce on. Thank you. Okay, so let's get back to some of the other responses we're seeing just from simply growing a winter rye cover crop on these corn silage fields, and why I think we're seeing a yield response beyond the 30 pounds of nitrogen. Again, this is that long-term study. You know, we aren't seeing any increase in total organic matter, which is very disappointing to our farmers, but you can understand why, and Steve already talked about this. They're plowing under something that's like a chocolate bar, so it gets eaten up really quickly, and there's not a lot there to build long-term organic matter over time, and so we're not seeing that. But we do see an improvement in water-stable aggregation. Farmers see this because they know their fields are draining better, okay? And then we see a little boost in active carbon, which I think most people know is the stuff that the microbes eat, okay? And that's how the nutrients get cycled in these soil. So we do see an improvement in soil health. And again, this is just from, you know, October to mid-May. So just that little bit of time, how important having that cover crop there is to these fields. It's actually pretty phenomenal what a difference they can make in these soils. So this is that 2014 data I showed you before with the yields, and I just wanted to show a couple other things that our farmers are really onto. This water holding capacity. Our farmers are getting pretty sophisticated with how they actually manipulate these things now, you know, letting them ride out a little bit longer to dry the ground out. And in 2014, we actually really saw the soil dried out by the cover crops quite substantially. And so farmers are actually taking advantage of that, letting them grow a little bit longer to dry the fields out before they work them up. I think it's great. Aggregate stability, again, the difference that we see in the lowest in continuous corn, and a boost with just growing that winter cover crop. And of course, you know, the highest being with perennial forage or new corn out of perennial forage. And this is no-till corn, okay? And again, no difference in organic matter. But this is what I'm after. This is what we should all be after, is planning, intentional growing of cover crops, becoming a part of our nutrient management planning, our cropping systems, not an afterthought. Not, well, it's going to be a decent corn year this year. I'll be able to get it off early enough to plant a cover crop. It should be something that we're intentionally trying to make sure we absolutely get done. And how do we adjust all of our crops to be able to get it done? And I'm starting to think about things really differently, and so aren't our farmers. As an example, we know now that when we're trying to use the highboy to interseed into standing corn, if the corn has upright leaves, we get a better establishment. We grow silage corn at 34,000 to 38,000 plants per acre. How are you going to establish a cover crop in a forest? So do we need to start thinking differently about how we grow our crops so that we can grow our other crops too? Redesigning our cropping plans to not just fit in cover crops, but to make them truly a part of the system so that we reap the benefits from growing them. Okay, because they have economic value. And farmers have seen that, and we have shown that. Okay, so this is our planting schedule now for cover crops that we look at. And we have to plant earlier season corn. That's one thing. Farmers fought that forever, and things are changing. What we've essentially found is that it's all about variety selection. It's not how long of a season of a corn you can grow, because we have 80-day corns that yield just as well as 110-day corns. This is silage, of course, okay? And, you know, planting these the third week of May, these early season varieties, means we're harvesting at the beginning of September, and we have time to get that cover crop in, get good growth on it, take up some nitrogen, so on and so forth, get those roots down in the ground, okay? If we're growing these long season crops, we're not harvesting until October. And right then, you're too late, really, to maximize the benefit of cover crops. So this is an afterthought. This is planning. We want this, OK? Okay, you got to plan for that. All right. And then this is just the data, some data that Masood, I don't know if he's in here, and Steve Herbert collected. Just looking again at the effect of planting date on the amount of nitrogen that the cover crops take up and then subsequently release the next season. And I think you guys have heard this over and over again, probably through this conference, that planting date matters. And when cover crops aren't an afterthought, you're actually planning to plant them early, not late. Okay. And this again is in Vermont, so you can just see the amount of biomass that's produced early on versus, you know, once you get into October and November, which this is a reality for us if we're not planning to get that corn off. Okay. We see percent nitrogen levels in our winter rye between 2 and 4%. I mean, that's pretty standard across the board. 4% when there's quite a bit of manure applied and 2% when there's not. Okay. And that's what we tell farmers to plan on. How much biomass, estimate how much biomass is there, and then you can estimate how much nitrogen. But honestly, for the most part, you know, where we see most cover crops planted are right here, and that's when we're getting that 45 pounds of nitrogen. Okay. There are a lot of tools out there if you work with farmers to help them actually estimate percent nitrogen and cover and nitrogen available from those cover crops. And I don't know if Marianne Sarantonio is here, but she has a wonderful book on cover crops in the Northeast with a lot of data that she collected when she was at the Rodale. And I mean, we use these tables all the time to work with farmers, and you know, we're creating new information, but if you need something now, this is great stuff. You know, and our data supports this too, so I don't see any need to like keep going personally for myself. You know, so grasses above ground pre-flowering 2 to 3.5% nitrogen. Okay, and then she's got these great lookup tables for hairy vetch, winter rye, and some legumes, where basically you look at your height, ground cover, this is about where we're at, 1,000 pounds to 1,500 pounds. I mean, her stuff is pretty spot on and is a good just tool for you guys to be using if you're working with farmers right now. It's really great. And then, you know, in that book, she goes through all these calculations that you can do to just come up with, you know, a best guesstimate of nitrogen if you're working with farmers or if you are a farmer. Probably out of time, so I don't get to talk about this, but our farmers are most excited about this. Oh, I can harvest cover crops for feed? Wow, right? And we have a lot of farmers doing that now, and it's really helped them recover from a bunch of bad years. You know, you have a bad year and you don't get enough stored feed put up for your cattle, what happens? Got to buy feed, costs money. Got to buy more grain, costs money. Okay, having that cover crop has saved a lot of people over the number of years that we've had that have been very challenging to get high yielding crops. They're actually going out there and grazing them or harvesting them as heifer feed. And you know, our dairy, our organic dairies and grass-based dairies now that are grazing these pretty regularly actually find they can get the cows out of the barn about 2 weeks earlier, sometimes 3 weeks earlier, than waiting for their perennial pasture to start producing. This makes you money. It's nice to get those cows out of the barn a few weeks ahead of time. Good for the cows, good for the bottom line, okay? So we've been doing a lot of work trying to figure out what cover crops fit best for forage. Really important, heading dates and biomass and all those things. And this data is available on our website. I know we don't have time. And then lastly, our farmers are taking the little bit that we know and then just making it go and really coming up with some interesting cropping systems and strategies to actually incorporate cover crops. New crops, annual crops, into their dairy systems. And people are really excited about this. It's added a new sort of level of excitement on farms, something to experiment with. Okay, so, you know, people are doing all kinds of things with this. Really, on our grass-based dairies, it's really to take perennial fields out of production and refurbish them, and taking about a year to grow three different annual crops to do that. You know, so they're starting with cereal grains, and then they're moving into summer annuals, and then they're moving into cereal grains again with brassicas. And this is good if you graze cows or you feed cows, it's good feed. Okay? And here's some cows out on triticale first thing in the spring. You know, the leaves are barely coming out on the trees, and these cows are loving life. Okay? Farmers love this stuff. And now we're working with farmers to look at mixtures, you know, so we will get these mixtures on our farm and look at increases in protein and so on and so forth. And the way our farmers look at this is if they can't take it for feed or graze it, then they get nitrogen from it and they get a green manure benefit. So a lot of exciting stuff happening on our farms. We can grow radishes in Vermont too, but that's an outlier. That one, the seed dropped, not in the field, and it grew really big, so I feel like we all compare radish size. Is that something, right? Come on, everybody's doing it. If my radish was this big. I know, and that's not even as big as some of the ones I've seen. But anyway, but that's a nice thing about forage systems. You know, you can use all these things as feed. Cover crops, you know, double duty on these things. Anyway, okay. This is different than what Steve wanted me to talk about, so I hope you guys didn't mind. It's okay, right? Yeah, okay. I told him I was going to do whatever the heck I wanted, so you can't tell me what to do. Anyway, any questions?
Yeah, Heather, I was curious, when you showed about a ton and a half yield increase from those cover crops, was manure still in the system, or did you pull manure from that system?
In the long term, where we had averaged all the yields, and there was almost an approximate two-ton increase, there has been manure in that system. But in the 2014 data, there was no manure in that system.
Okay, but your averages are showing that yield increase even when you keep manure in the system.
Yes. Yep.